Okay, there are no satellites. If you are believing there are satellites, and you think there is an excess of 130,000 of them up there, which by common calculation is probably conservative, going round and round the garden above our heads, how come none have ever fallen on us? How come they don't collide with one another? How come they don't go wrong? How come? How come in 1954 there were satellite dishes, if you like, look like satellite dishes, on the ground, pointing around the earth and up to the sky? There you go, so definitely satellites then. What were they shooting at? They weren't shooting the information at satellites. They were shooting it and bouncing it off the ionosphere. That's the ozone layer. Ozone, within 30 seconds of exposure to ultraviolet light, is ionized within 30 seconds. So we might have an ozone layer, but it lasts for about 30 seconds before it becomes ionized, and that is the ionosphere. And it is that the dishes are pointing at, not satellites. There are no satellites, folks. It's a lie. A nice one, a lucrative one, but it's a lie. Ham radio people have been bouncing off, and TV and the others, have been bouncing off the ionosphere for years. Even Tesla was doing it. Anyway, except there are no satellites, that's number two. Number three, except that there are no such things as planets that you can land an aeroplane or a spaceship on. There are none. There are stars, there are gaseous balls, and there are wandering stars. And the wandering stars, those without a home on our firmament, are the planets. What we perceive as planets, but in no way can you land anything on them. And we can't take photographs of them, not with standard photography. And those pictures of all the different planets, Jupiter, Mars, Pluto, Venus, Saturn, blah-de-blah-de-blah, for the most part are computer-generated images. Pretty pictures, just like that NASA do of the Earth. Yes. Understand that and accept it. Don't even think about investigating the flat earth until you got your head around what I'm saying here. No space travel with known technology. No satellites floating around our heads. No planets, just gas balls wandering about. Here's another one. The moon and sun are within our firmament, which is like a Center Parcs dome above our earth, our plane, our circular plane. We're in a Center Parcs, and within the Center Parcs, folks, is the sun and the moon going round and round the garden like a teddy bear. Except that the sun is not 93 million miles away. Stars are not light years away. And the moon's not that far away. The moon is the latest addition. The sun was here before the moon. Okay, understand that. The moon was put in late for a very good reason. It's a suppressor. It's a repeater station. That's all. Understand that. And it is within our firmament. It is no more than 3,500 miles high, and nor is the sun. And here's the biggie. This is a real tough one for you to get your head around, I suppose. I know they wouldn't, but they do. NASA lie. NASA stands for Never a Straight Answer. NASA. Now, we could get technical, I could give a slide rule out. We can talk till the cows come home about you've got all the evidence. But ask yourself who wrote the fucking textbooks. Ask yourself, the moment you went into school, the first thing that was shoved into your hand, children, was a globe. Every poster on the bloody school that I went to, the first school, 5 years old, straight out the crying arms of my mother and mine. On the wall was pictures of the planets and pictures of the earth and bloody globes everywhere. At 5 years old. It begs the question, if indeed we are on a flat plane, and I believe we are, who gains by the deception? Who out there would lie? Well, the amazing thing in the early days, of course, it was never considered that we lived on anything but a flat plane. It was no big deal. All the shipping maps don't take into account the curvature of the world. They're flat. Okay, of late, aeronautical maps don't take into the account or nature of the curvature of the world. Navigation maps, they don't. The new standard map of the world doesn't take into account a curvature. Those engineers who are building the G2 railway station road track, I know a couple, I live near one of them. People who lay railway tracks don't need to compensate for the curvature up or down of the curvature of the world. A ship doesn't have to put extra fuel in to compensate for the extra distance due to the curvature. It plots a point between two points and it's a straight line, and they calculate their fuel requirements, and so do aircraft. Pilots don't sit there pushing continuously forward on the stick to fly in harmony with the curvature of the earth. I know, because I'm a pilot. Not to mention the Coriolis effect, which you can wax lyrical about. How come the polar star is dead still? And all the other stars go round and round and round, and they have done. And this Leo star sign rotates like a clock around the polar star. So NASA and the black nobility who run this world have a lot to gain keeping us in the dark.